Spillers Records in the heart of Cardiff is acknowledged by the Guinness Book of Records as the oldest record shop in the world. Though its shop front is unassuming and its interior humble, it has nevertheless remained an inspiration for aspiring rock stars and music lovers for generations. Some people think they're always right. Others are quiet and uptight. Though now its future is uncertain. With the regeneration of the Hayes area of the city centre, is there still room amidst the high street chains for what some consider a niche record shop? Whatever the outcome, history has proved that Spillers Records have a habit of surviving against the odds. In the late 1900s, Cardiff was by far Wales's largest industrial centre. Spurred on by the Industrial Revolution, its primary function was to service the needs of the rapidly growing mining industry in the valleys of South Wales.
In the 1890s, when Spillers began, of course, Cardiff was at its height. It was growing prodigiously fast. There were 130,000 people in Cardiff by 1891, compared with less than 2,000 at the beginning of the century. It had grown by 56% in the 1880s, which was the fastest growth of any town in Britain, probably any town in Europe at the time. It was really boom times for Cardiff. The key, of course, was the trade of the docks. The whole world depended upon a source of heat and energy, which was delivered by the port of Cardiff. And not just Europe, France, Italy, but places like Chile, South America, Brazil. By the turn of the 20th century, the coal exchange in Mount Stuart Square in Cardiff's docks determined the price of coal. And it's very significant, I think, that the first world deal dealing with more than £1 million occurred in the coal exchange at the beginning of the 20th century.
So, Cardiff was an ideal place for any new business venture, as aspiring entrepreneurs Henry Spiller and accordion player Joe Gregory discovered when they decided to open a music shop. They were convinced that new music technology, such as Thomas Edison's recently invented phonograph, would have a phenomenal impact on the way people listen to music. For several years, the shop could be found in Castle Arcade off St. Mary's Street, though on moving to Queen's Arcade, they soon settled in. They sold phonographs, wax phonograph cylinders, and shellac phonograph discs. They also carried out repairs, sold musical instruments, and of course, records. This was also the time that Henry Spiller met his wife-to-be, Gertrude.
My grandfather met my grandmother about 1903. She was a milliner next door to him, and I can remember her telling me that she sold lots of walking sticks and pretty umbrellas and made pretty hats.
They had three children, Edward, Henry Jr. and Irene. Henry Spiller was a proud grandfather.
He was a short little man, very quiet gentleman who was always very polite, really nice to people. He was mostly interested in doing the mechanical side of things, mending the old record players, putting the springs in to set them going again, and I think they only cost a few pennies, I believe, to do.
With Henry's passion for technology and the mechanisms behind the music, the shop went from strength to strength. Though driving and underscoring this passion was Henry's love of classical music. For the wealthy shipowners now thriving in Cardiff, this new technology was an opportunity to show off their success and status. Though the sailors, arriving from as far away as the West Indies, had different needs.
A lot of sailors came in to hire musical instruments, take them off with them and then come back and pay for another month's hiring, or 6 months if they went off. Lots of colourful characters from down Cardiff docks. They came in and they bought strings to go on their guitars.
With the workers and businessmen spending their hard-earned money, the shops thrived, and the good times for industry continued. Under the influence of this new wealth, Cardiff grew in size until it was officially given city status by Edward VII in 1905. The expansion of the docks area and flourishing architecture reflected Cardiff's thriving trade status and population expansion. But World War I was about to change all of that.
The whole industrial base of Cardiff expanded very rapidly during the war, including the major steelworks at East Moors and major manufacturing works down the docks. And then, after a slight boom after the First World War, it all collapsed. The world demand for coal went spiraling down as people began finding that oil, petrol for cars, petrol for ships, oil for ships, this was much more convenient material that just gushed out of the earth without anybody having to dig it out. And by the 1930s, Cardiff's trade was half of what it had been, and people were talking about the Bute Docks, which had been so hugely prosperous, as Cardiff's withered arm.
With the arrival of World War II, Spillers suffered like many businesses in Cardiff, with so many men being sent away to fight for their country. The demand for music and repairs, of course, were minimal.
My father reckoned they could have been made millionaires, but the war was coming, and I think there was trouble with money with the men that were hiring these instruments. I think they were losing money, I think, at the time.
Edward, the eldest Spiller's son, was one of the thousands conscripted into the services, so Henry Sr. had a new assistant to help him with the day-to-day running of the shop, his granddaughter, Val.
As you walked in, it wasn't very big. There was, on the right, there was a counter, and in front of you was a counter. And at the back, underneath the stairs, was a little place where you could make tea and coffee. If you needed the toilet, you had to go down the arcade, down a little lane to the loo.
Henry was still passionate about mechanics and allowed Val an insight into his luxuries.
Upstairs then, he had all his musical instruments, where he used to mend the record players, and I used to be there and I used to fill the little tins with needles that you had to use to play. About 25, I think, you had to put in a box. I think they sold them for about sixpence.
Through all this, the soundtrack of war continued. But was the shop really the safest place to be?
Unlike some of the cities of Britain, Swansea, for example, its middle was totally destroyed. Places like Coventry, Southampton, Hull, they were very seriously damaged. Cardiff was bombed, but the centre of Cardiff remained intact, which made it a fortunate city, in a way, during the war.
With Cardiff still on its feet and Queen's Arcade unscathed, Spillers remained open for business as usual. Servicemen returned home, and life was breathed back into the city again. Edward Spiller came home from the war safely, and soon he and brother Henry Jr. began to take greater control of the shop. And in the euphoric atmosphere of post-war Britain, music was on the up.
A lot of the music was dance music. The RAF came in, and they would be there for hours choosing their dancing records.
The shop was a popular hangout for servicemen, though it wasn't always the records they were interested in.
Two sisters married two boys from the RAF, and this is what was happening. They were all meeting these boys, coming in for their dance records, and going off and marrying them, and we didn't see them again.
The euphoria didn't last long. After World War II, demand for coal slumped further, and the growing oil industry left the docks dried up and washed out.
After the war, with the coming of the Labour government and the nationalisation of coal, there was a new feeling of optimism. But of course, the very factors that had caused the coal industry to contract in the 1920s and the 30s, the coming of oil, became even more marked in the 1950s and 60s, where virtually all the world's shipping changed to oil.
And as the face of Cardiff was transformed again by industry, or the lack of it, so the Spillers family suffered its own loss. Henry Spiller died in 1951. 2 years later, the family were forced by the landlord to leave their premises in the Queen's Arcade and to relocate to the Hayes area of the city, near the popular department store David Morgan's. They moved to an unassuming little shop.
It was originally a tea shop selling teas, i.e. packets of teas, we believe, salmons. And then when we moved in, it was a shoe shop. And there was hundreds of shoes left in the cellar. We had to clear it all out. They moved in there, and it's been there ever since.
Spiller's Records soon settled into its new home in the Hayes. Though little did the family know that just round the corner, the Cardiff music scene was about to be revolutionised. By the early 50s, it was the turn of the second generation of Spillers. With the sudden death of Henry Jr. in 1953, Edward and his wife Elsie were left in charge of the family shop. Though Edward was no businessman like his father, he was more of a free spirit. Even in the early days in the Queen's Arcade, he enjoyed numerous European escapades with his friends.
My father's attitude towards the shop was very laid back. I think my mother took the biggest role of all. She was the brains behind it in the end. My dad would roll in about 12 o'clock and the staff would give him a cup of tea in one hand and the Financial Times and the Western Mail, and he'd sit and read that. Then he'd go and have lunch in the Louis Cafe with whoever he could from the Western Mail. He'd talk and chat. Then he'd eventually come back 3 o'clock. Do a little bit of work. But he said he never sold a record in his life. They just sold themselves. We're known really for our classical. Both my parents knew quite a bit about it. But also then, of course, you had the youngsters, especially on a Saturday, they'd all come in for their pop music. And there were singles in those days.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock around. It's like tonight,
break. Britain was in the midst of a rock and roll revolution, and Cardiff welcomed it with open arms. In the dance halls and theatres, people were desperate to be part of this new musical phenomenon.
For live music, it was terrific. I mean, it was obviously rock and roll, but I mean, there were so many small dances, small places, like there's the Kennard Rooms, there was the Victor Sylvester Ballroom underneath the Capitol, there was the Pavlova Ballroom in Ely. There was the St. David's Hall, and there were just so many small dances, and they were all cheap.
But while the streets of Cardiff, now the capital city of Wales, were dancing to rock and roll, other areas of the city were moving to a different beat. Cardiff Bay had found its own rhythm.
Who wants to help me burn my candle?
New musical talents were emerging in Tiger Bay, among them a young Shirley Bassey.
Woman, how much he spent.
Cardiff Bay experienced a huge influx of people around this time from a spectrum of ethnic backgrounds.
A lot of seamen came from the United States, and they used to bring jitterbug and rhythm and blues records with them. But also GIs used to come down from the American bases, and one of the reasons they came to Tiger Bay, the black GIs that is, was because this was such a multi-ethnic community, and they could find women of colour, if you will, in the community. And as the many of the girls made boyfriends out of these GIs. They often came and they stayed in local people's homes. They didn't stay in hotels. And so when they came, they brought a lot of goodies. It was post-World War II, so things were scarce, but they brought a lot of things, sweets, candies, and records. And their records, the little 45s, were like something from outer space to us in those days, because we were still using those big 78 breakable records. And all of their music was completely new to us.
Once the doors were opened to this new music, people couldn't get enough of it. They'd trawl the airwaves in search of Radio Luxembourg or Caroline just to hear their favourite single. Radios everywhere were tuned in to these new stations where more and more music could be heard. But listening wasn't enough. They wanted to own these sounds for themselves.
Remember Howells opening up a pretty big record department that you could actually take the records at one time into the booth and you would play them on individual record players? Well, the records went, and I think one or two of the record players, so they stopped doing that. But I can remember going in there and asking for Sea Cruise by Frankie Ford and being told by the woman there to stop making these titles up. And then a little later on, going to this smaller record shop in Queen Street and asking for Two Burka Lucas and the Sinus Blues by Huey Piano Smith and the Clowns on the Sioux label, and the man saying, out, get out the shop, out, before we call the police, go.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain.
But what did Mr. and Mrs. Spiller make of this new music? Edward Spiller's tastes were particularly challenged during this time.
Great balls of fire.
He didn't like pop music at all. We used to tease him that this was your bread and butter, Dad, these these Beatles and these Elvises. No, he didn't like pop at all.
Edward remained passionate about his classical music. He even built a room at the back of the shop where other classical enthusiasts could immerse themselves. And as for the modern music, well, Spillers had the good sense to employ people who had a knowledge and passion for it.
Spillers Record Shop was a main sort of mecca for the records down the docks, for the docks people.
Spillers was like coming home. You asked for rock and roll records and they understood exactly what you meant. There's an arcade next to Spillers, which was a stamp shop. And as a child, I'd been quite interested in stamps, so I soon outgrew that thing. You know, I discovered tops on bathing suits and all this wonderful music. But I still had this stamp collection. I can remember going in there and selling my stamp collection for 7 and 6 and going to the Spillers and buying Rebel Rouser by Duane Eddy. So it, and that's a great record.
You walked in, it was quite bright, much brighter than it looks today, and it had a long counter, and at the end was a turntable where they played records. And
it seemed to be brown wooden counters. There wasn't any bright colours apart from the posters that were up.
You just walked up to the counter and they would, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Spiller were kind of stately, a lot of posh type couple.
It was like Miss Marple with Bebop and Lula playing. So it was like a traditional sort of shop with all these old squares in there. And these groovy chicks.
Listening to the records that came directly from the States, we wanted to own them and try to buy them. So I'd go up to Mr. and Mrs. Spill and I'd say, could you order me certain records? And so they wouldn't be in the shop, so she'd go in a book and then she'd look up the number and then she'd put an order. She'd say, well, come back next week and we'll see if we got it. And I'd be going there nearly every other day. Have you got it yet, Mrs. Spiller? Have you got it? And then one day it would be there. Now, and then she said, can I play it? So she would play the record in the shop, and she'd never heard this before. She said, well, where do you hear these records, you know? And we say, well, everybody got them down the docks, you know?
While Mr. and Mrs. Spiller were never fans of the Beatles or Elvis, as the years rolled on, they gradually became influenced and seduced by their customers' tastes.
I love you, Porgy, don't let them take me.
Well, they were as excited about it as I was. And I guess the other people who came from Tiger Bay and bought records in there, they really enjoyed that music. And so they must have had a very eclectic taste in music.
You can keep me, I wanna stay with you forever, and I'll be glad.
It was the lifeblood of being to have the music around you. You wanted to hear it all the time.
As the music bought from this unassuming shop echoed in the streets, by the 60s, Spillers had gained legendary status with the music lovers of Cardiff.
Well, it was said amongst the kids at the time, and with the adults as well, it was sort of an established thing that Spillers would stock a sample, at least, of every single release.
The wind had changed again for Cardiff in the 1960s. While the city homes had survived World War II, they couldn't endure the growing shopping industry. Tiger Bay was demolished, and its residents moved to high-rise flats on the outskirts of the city. For Edward and Elsie too, it was time for a change.
My mother particularly, she was coming up to 60 and she wanted to retire. And so we sold it. And it was a sad day really, I think, very sad. But yes, Dad never spoke much about it after that.
I wanna stay here with you forever.
I don't think my folks ever went back to the shop ever again. But I just wanted to go there. And I used to buy the odd record there, but I never ever said who I was.
While it would soon be the turn of a new manager to take the helm of the shop and create his own legacy, for Val, fond memories are only a record away.
I think it's sort of an intimate thing coming in to buy records. I put one on the other day, I tell you. I put one on the other day, right? And I was in the shop.
I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart, you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin.
I tried so not to give in. I said to myself, this affair never will go so well. But why should I try to resist when, darling, I know so well.
Spillers Records in the heart of Cardiff is acknowledged by the Guinness Book of Records as the oldest record shop in the world. Originally opened by Henry Spiller as a classical music shop in 1894, it has proved itself an enduring survivor. It has survived two world wars, the rise and decline of the industrial age, and the rock and roll revolution. But in the present day, its long-term future remains in grave doubt. Cardiff in the 1960s was quickly becoming a shopping metropolis, with department stores and shops opening all over the capital, and music was at the top of many people's shopping lists. Everyone was keen to keep their singles collections up to date, and Spillers Records was the place to go. Local bands had specific, selective demands of their music. Bands like Amen Corner.
We were always interested in all the new import records. We weren't particularly interested in any of the chart stuff particularly. The only place you could buy those kind of records would be in an independent record shop, such as Spillers.
So, of course, for a local band, it would be a landmark moment to find their single for sale in their favourite record shop.
It would have been 1967, I suppose. The first record that we had out was Gin House Blues, which was being played on Radio Caroline. And we came in I think the whole band would have been probably rehearsing nearby. Somebody came in and noticed that the record was in the shop, which was a real thrill for us, because obviously it was amongst all our, you know, heroes really. We were a local band. I guess they got well behind it.
Though while shopping and retail were booming in the city centre, its industrial heart was beating a little slower. By the 1970s, Eastmoor Steelworks had closed down and trade in the docks was virtually non-existent. Cardiff needed a new direction. It had been the Welsh capital since 1955. It was now time to celebrate this status.
Once you begin to think in terms of what institutions you put in a capital, such as the Welsh Office, the huge creation of the Welsh Office in Cadiz Park in that period, the beginnings, of course, of a serious media business in Cardiff, which again was a tribute to the fact that it was the capital, these were the saving graces of the period.
By the 1970s, the businessmen who were running Spillers had lost touch with their customers. This ongoing disillusionment could easily have led to its closure. But thankfully, a loyal customer intervened and saved the shop.
I was a customer here for a number of years before I came to work here, and I DJed for probably 4 or 5 years before I came actually to work in Spillers. I was in here, and I've got to say, a number of other record shops in Cardiff, but Spillers were always the best shop that you could order from. So I guess I was here a couple of times a week. I happened to be in here on the day that the current then manageress decided that she didn't want to do the job anymore and put it to me something like, "Nick, I don't want to do this job anymore, but I know you could. Would you like me to recommend you for it?" I said, "Thank you very much, yes, please."
The owners at the time were baffled as to why the shop was doing so badly, where once it had been brimming with customers.
I remember Mr. Porter, my immediate boss at the time, saying that at one point the Spillers was doing nearly 60% of Cardiff's record trade. I think when I came here it was less than 5%. Business was pretty poor. Sales for rock and pop albums, which in the 60s had taken off big time, was negligible at the time I started here. We didn't even have Pink Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon in stock. One good thing about music,
when it is good. Nick took an uncomplicated approach to the business. By simply listening to the customers while introducing his own tastes, the shop was soon turned around. There was no grand business plan behind him, just enthusiasm and a love of music.
I was indulging a passion, I think, rather than actually thinking about what we should be selling. The best in any business is to be customer-led. I am
an antichrist. But how far was Nick willing to go? When punk arrived in all its glory in Caerphilly, local people were up in arms in protest.
How do you feel about the crowd opposite?
They're entitled to do what they want.
All the publicity that's hit you, has it helped or hindered?
Both.
We hope tonight by this protest to make Wales know, to let the people of this town know, that we do protest, and it is by no fault of ours that this thing has come to Caerphilly.
Everyone had their opinion about this new music, be it a protest or a party. But what did Spillers make of it all?
The haze became a magnet for punks to congregate. You could have 200 or 300 punks out on the haze on a Saturday, and a lot of the time, most of them would want to come into Spillers. At one time, I had to get a friend of mine to be a security guard on the door. Not because of any problem with any behaviour of the punks, but it was just we were so popular that I couldn't accommodate them all at one time to come in the shop. We were renowned for punk music, but we were also had a good name for classical music, and I think we were probably one of the few that mixed those two genres.
In the 1980s, rock and heavy metal was also popular. Loud and brash, their music genres often associated with working-class industrial towns. Cardiff is a city surrounded by towns with an industrial heritage. The financial benefits to the city were huge.
Within close proximity to Cardiff, you've got Newport, which is over 100,000. You've got Barry at 40,000. You've got Pontypridd at 40,000. Caerphilly. So that, in fact, Cardiff is the centre of a city region of between 1.5 and 2 million people, which gives it a far greater base in terms of population and possibilities for development than more isolated cities.
Spillers, at the heart of this huge consumer catchment area, could not be better placed to provide music to the people of South Wales. On a Saturday afternoon, it became the mecca for Valley's boys and girls in search of industrially fueled music.
We couldn't get enough people in the shop that wanted to shop here at the time. It's a wonderful position to be in retail or any business.
The shop door was open to everyone, no matter what your style or taste in music.
It's quite small and cluttered in a way, but then there'd be punks in there, there'd be some skinheads, whatever, you know, the rockabillies, the scooter boys, into the northern soul, the hip-hop. It covered all the alternate scene. It was always funny at Christmas when someone's mother or dad had to go in there almost to look for a record they'd been on the Christmas list. And you could spot them a mile away, but everyone was just friendly and helpful in there. It didn't matter what music you were into.
But as the shop approached its centenary year, would it ever again reconnect with its original founding family? Henry Spiller's granddaughter Val had a chance encounter.
I lost contact with the shop, and then in the 1980s, we needed double glazing, and this fellow came, and we were sitting at the table deciding what was wanted, and he looked at the photograph on at the table and he said, I know that shop, my friend has got that. So I said, who's that? And he told me it was Nick Todd. So I said, oh yes. So he said, I'll tell him about it, about you. And he did, and so Nick and I got in touch, and I've been in touch with Nick ever since.
Well, that's how I know you were right, because it's
Val, now living in Narberth, visits the shop whenever she's in Cardiff.
It's the way
and
I can relate.
My grandmother died in 1964, and they were definitely here.
So, even after all these years, Spillers continues to be a family-run shop, with Nick's daughters, Ashley and Grace, heavily involved in its smooth running.
The shop does have a family tradition, and I was very pleased to see that Nick's daughters have been involved with it for years. It's a small shop, and I think there aren't many like that left at all in anywhere.
It's the only thing we've known, really. It's not, you know, it's not really something we've had a choice in. It's just been a part of our lives, and through that, the staff here have been part of our lives, as have the customers been part of our lives.
Growing up in the 1990s, Nick's children have experienced a very different Cardiff to the one Spillers first opened its doors to in 1894.
Over the last decades of the 20th century, what we've seen is Cardiff reinventing itself as a totally different sort of place. And Cardiff became not a working class city as it had been in the early 20th century. It became an essentially a centre for administration, trade, commerce, and eventually government, indeed.
So, with the city evolving, new and groundbreaking buildings being peppered amidst the old, grand, historic architecture, what place does Spillers have in today's Cardiff? Will it survive the regeneration and still be inspiring and influencing in another 100 years? Or has the fat lady finally sung? In the 21st century, the way we access and listen to music is changing so rapidly that some question the purpose of traditional record shops. When a music purchase is just a click away, who needs to go into a shop? But such convenience lacks the human touch, and nothing beats a live public performance.
They're not something new to the shop. They kind of have happened on and off throughout the years, but in the last 18 months there's been a real increase in them, sort of averaging about once a month.
I've never been in the back of Spillers before, it's very exciting. They've got a swimming pool and there's a cafeteria.
I did wonder a bit when we had Griff Rhys just 10 days ago. We actually ticketed that for the first time so that we didn't have too many people turned up. We still made the gig free, but we did it on a first come, first served basis.
While Spillers struggles to keep the spirit of music alive, its immediate future is uncertain. After 32 years, manager Nick Todd has decided to sell the business. Family matters are at the heart of his decision-making. Nick and his co-owner ex-wife are recently divorced.
The shop's for sale because the alternative would have been to buy my ex-wife out as a divorce settlement. Might have been partly a reaction to the divorce, but I took stock of my life and I thought 32 years of enjoyment of running Spillers, I'd like a change. I'm going to retire at some point. It might have been earlier from this business than I'd have chosen, but it just seemed an appropriate time in my life to try something else.
While Nick plans a new career as a lorry driver, selling the shop proves extremely difficult. The Hayes area of town, once a shopping mecca, is having a complete overhaul. St. David's 2, a new indoor shopping arcade, will become the largest in Europe.
In the last 12 months, trade has taken a nosedive again. Mainly, I think, the redevelopment going on around us that is responsible. I heard a lady a couple of weeks ago walking down off the Hayes as I was coming into work, turned to a friend with her. They both had shopping bags, and the comment was, "Why do we come to Cardiff just for a building site?"
But while small businesses struggle to survive, how would the landlord's helical bar support them in the long period of development before the new arcade opens? For Nick to sell the shop, it would need to be an attractive business venture.
The landlords were anything but supportive at the beginning. About late September last year, when a buyer came forward who was interested in purchasing Spillers, I got called for a meeting with the landlord's agents and had the bombshell of an 85% rent increase floated in front of me. And I'd had a buyer interested who didn't withdraw but came in with an offer substantially less than the figure he'd been indicating, because of the proposed rent increase.
Without a change to the landlord's demands, it would be impossible for Nick to find a reasonable buyer.
Dear landlord, please don't put a price on my soul.
It was a depressing and uneasy time for his family, and for others connected to the shop, it was a shock.
My burden is heavy. My dreams are beyond control.
When I heard that the shop was going to close, I was bereaved. I was heartbroken, really, to think that, yes, part of me, part of the family, is going from Cardiff, and it would be very sad if it all finished. Very, very sad, I think. I would really miss it not being there.
Obviously, we don't want it to close. I think not just for personal reasons, but because it's such an asset to Cardiff and to music lovers.
Yeah. If it is something that happens, it will obviously be a great loss to both of us in our personal lives and, you know,
in the wider
sense as well.
But Spillers would find a champion to argue their corner. Howell Thomas, then applied Cymru press officer, walked past Spillers every day to work.
having sort of lived in the city all my life, I felt sad, but I also felt angry. I work at the Assembly as a press officer, and I wanted to use my position there to help the shop, I suppose. So I raised a statement of opinion, which got the backing of Assembly members from all parties. Then I wrote a petition, which received some like 3,000 signatures in the first 2 weeks. And I got support from the Manic Street Preachers to give it, I suppose, a little boost and increase the profile of the campaign. And I think 8,500 people have signed to date.
The petition soon gained momentum. Howell was contacted by Columbia Records, the world's oldest record label, founded in 1863. They offered their support. Soon, heavyweight artists such as Bob Dylan and Bruce Springsteen gave backing to the campaign.
I am just staggered at how many people that have actually gone to the trouble of either going online or coming to the shop to specifically sign the petition.
The shop has come a long way, but how would the original Spiller family feel about the support? Edward Spiller ran the shop in the 1950s.
I think he would be very proud to think that people want it to carry on, and people have been writing so much and ask and saying all the things they can remember about coming in the shop. I think he'd be very proud. I think he'd be very surprised to think that it's still going and Nick has done such a good job to keep it going.
But in today's environment of easy music consumption, what makes Spillers so special?
These days it seems that, you know, people working behind shop counters don't really, it's just a job for them, you know, where I think it's more of a way of life with, you know, the Spillers and their tradition, and the people that have worked in the shops have always cared about the music.
I think they've had a strong community concern. You know, they stock records by local bands, and they, you know, advertise events for local bands, and they are part of the whole musical fabric of South Wales.
With my records, you can buy them from Russia to Japan, Australia, America, but if you try and find them in my home country, more than likely the only place you'll find is Spillers. If they had to set up a government scheme to help musicians or artists, they could spend a lot of money trying to recreate Spillers when they could just save it and save the money.
For many people, Spillers is a key part of Cardiff's identity.
It's part of the city's character. It's what makes Cardiff different. Like David Morgan's that closed down 2 years ago after 125 years in the city. And I don't want Cardiff to end up as some sort of clone town, you know, no different to any other city in Britain. I don't think the citizens of Cardiff want that either.
But despite the huge public support, without finding a suitable buyer, the future for the shop is grave.
I would be hurt if we have to close, but if commercially that's the only answer to us, I have to be big enough to accept that, and so does everybody else that loves the business have to accept it.
Just as closure seemed inevitable, the landlord showed mercy and offered the shop a lifeline.
We've had a lot of publicity, as you're aware, which staggered me, but I think it staggered the landlords as much. And the current situation is they don't intend doing anything about a rent rise for us.
Nick, too, has also been swayed by public opinion. Spillers remains open, despite recent roofing problems towards the end of 2007 that led to the shopfront being covered in scaffolding for several months.
The business is going to continue trading, which I and so many people seem to want. We're probably a year, 18 months over that development across the road from us, if not being open, at least looking quite nice. And Cardiff will start to attract the level of shopping that it's traditionally enjoyed in the past. In the long term, as much as I still feel young and chirpy, realistically, this business is going to need somebody else to run it, and somebody who can make a level of investment in it.
But no one doubts Nick's loyalty to the Spiller name.
I think he's been fantastic, and he's really been proud of the name. Very, very proud. And he had one time thought of changing his name to Spiller.
It is true. It is true.
Did.
Whilst I like my own name, I was so firmly ensconced in Spillers, I felt like a Spiller. And I had a great compliment paid to me just before Christmas. Val's sister, Pam from Canada, started emailing me and said, my grandfather, after 32 years of being in Spillers, would have regarded you as a grandson. So I didn't need to change the name.
It's nearly time to check out all the BMX action from the LG Action Sports Championships in Texas, USA. Free riders coming up next. Then it's time for another Night Watch with Steve Scott here at 12:10.